Hello, good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us for this session of this scientific conference dedicated to 30 years of the database of Japan. When I prepared this talk, I somehow reflected that though Japan is an Asian nation, it's very different from most other countries in the region by the fact that it has a more than 100-year-old scientific history driven by people from Japan. I'm currently located in Singapore. Essentially, 20 years ago, there was no biomedical research in Singapore driven by local representations. And this has changed, and my being there is part of that effort. And but it also colors how the political leadership, including the government of the country, develops and evaluates the successes and achievements in this domain. Yeah. 30 years of DNA database of Japan with the follow-up of all kinds of other databases was a very far-sighted, positive decision, and congratulations that the necessary movement has been made at such an early stage, so that Japan has such a great contribution to the work in this field. I saw the acknowledgement list of my previous speaker. Yeah, saw there some names like Go and Nishikawa, who were household names during my PhD time. Yeah, so there is something to learn from. Yeah, yeah. It's even more remarkable that the database effort in Japan was aligned with the efforts in other countries to form a joint trust. And I think this is an example how people from different nations can put together the best they have for the common good. Given that times are changing, I see that maybe we should spend some thought how to integrate other upcoming nations in this database effort, most notably China. Let's say, I guess at some stage we will also see a need of a development in India. Both countries are so large that each by its own is larger than United States, Europe, and Japan taken together. And let's say with a certain level of sequencing activity, they might produce more sequences than any other participant in this field. And I think it's important that all this effort gets integrated, and the existing players, I think, should come up with some ideas and proposals how to do this in a mutually beneficial manner. Yeah? One opportunity, for example, is the database effort that's currently supported by the Chinese Academy of Sciences at the Beijing Institute of Genomics. And I think it would be a gesture of goodwill to provide this effort with welcome and support, and use the resources and opportunities that are invested in China on that effort for a common good. Yeah, biomedical science in Singapore. Yeah. I'm heading the Bioinformatics Institute of ASTAR in Singapore since 2007. Originally, it was founded as a IT and bioinformatics support unit of the biomedical research community in Singapore. This idea led to some type of catastrophe because somewhere in 2006, early 2007, essentially there was mass resignation of young people from the institute because they were fed up to be used as service personnel in scientific projects where the laurels were harvested by others. And the institute was relaunched as a scientific research institution, still with the idea of extensive collaboration in the biomedical domain, but we reserved the right that we can decline collaboration projects if we find them scientifically or economically not sensible. Yeah, and this has made us much stronger in the negotiation, and as a result, we could build up a significant reputation in Singapore and elsewhere. The institute itself is focused on the analysis of different types of biological data, mainly sequence data, with the goal to understand the biological mechanisms that drive phenotypic developments. And the emphasis is really on mechanistic links between the two. We don't want to find statistical links between maybe genomic aberrations and let's say phenotypic traits. And this emphasis makes us different in the Singaporean environment. Since the expectation horizons of our founders is very short, most of our work is focused on biological data analysis with immediate outcome. We have some level of computational method development to the extent that is necessary for this specific work. We have also facilities for verification experiments. In the Singaporean environment, it's also very important to get engaged in all kinds of applications with immediate value. So we have lots of everyday interactions with industrial consortia, with clinical facilities, and so on. The institute is subdivided in four divisions. One division is essentially the analysis of omics data. We have a division where people focus on 3D structural studies and modeling efforts. A large division is engaged in the automated analysis of biological images of all kinds, mainly at the cellular and tissue level, with the goal of automated evaluation of large quantities of images in terms of quantitative biology. And finally, we have a translational research division where different developments from the other three divisions are used to create immediate value. Mainly, this translational research division is organized around a national organism library of 160,000 organism samples that we keep in our storages. A few numbers that characterize the institute. We have about 100 people, including all administration, IT service staff, and up to 20 scientific teams. The scientific output of the institute currently is 90 publications a year. Let's say three quarters or more of the projects are in collaboration with outside partners, and we generate several million dollars in industry contracts every year, and we also generate about twice the amount in grants from different places. We have quite some substantial international outreach. The IT capacity of the institute is significant, but is nothing outrageous. My personal view on that matter is that except for very few applications, IT has outpaced the demand of biomedical research. For maybe 95% of all projects, very standard equipment, typical Unix clusters or even workstations, batteries of standard from the shelf storage devices is more than sufficient for what we are doing. To give you an idea, the machine in front of myself in my early postdoctoral time was for the price of a quite expensive BMW. Today, for the price of such a BMW, I equip half of the institute. The institute also has experimental facilities. We have rule floor for molecular biology, protein, analytical chemistry, and the like, mostly occupied in natural product research. This is a graphic that shows the development of our publication activity. I entered the institute in 2007, and you see there's more than a doubling of publications since 2007. The organism library was given to our institute in 2014. This is essentially a recognition for the fact that our institute is the only one in ASTAR that has a systemic view on life science problems. And we are interested in any of the organisms that is contained in the library, whereas most other institutes would rather focus their interest on organisms that deliver compounds for combating cancer, influencing immunology. From the bioinformatics point of view, every genome is a problem, how to translate this via mechanisms into phenotypes. And all the organisms in the library are equally welcome for us. I told you already that most of our work is focused on biological or medical data analysis, and we don't have time, nor resources for methods and database development. This is slightly changing now because the hospitals in Singapore run into difficulties in dealing with the omics data in the precision medicine efforts. So as a result, we started developing a database for clinical data. It's designed as a secondary clinical data sink in addition to the data storages that the hospitals might have on their own. 2-3 years ago, when we started this effort, let's say essentially everybody was reluctant to deposit the data with us. First, the front was broken by the small hospitals who don't have enough capacity to deal with these problems in a professional manner on their own. And in the meantime, we have created professional infrastructure with a certified data center that's useful for even FDA-approved clinical trials. And we can now accept all kinds of clinical data. 5 major hospitals in Singapore have already started submitting data to us. And also some companies like Bayer require our Singaporean partners to deposit the trial data in the Bioinformatics Institute. I think a change in mind came when already at the time of data deposition, we could show that we can provide significant help to our clinical partners. For example, we run lots of plausibility tests over the data that's deposited with us, in addition to checks whether the data is complete, principally correct, and so on. For example, if there are different types of sequence data collected from the same patient, it is possible to check whether indeed the sequences collected are from the same patient. And we found out that in cases where genomic data, transcription data, and a genotype data was collected in a clinical trial, about 10% of the samples were mixed up. They were simply wrongly labeled in the laboratory. And we could even advise our clinical partners how to correctly relabel them. Then we can find already at the stage of data acceptance whether a data set is good for further analysis. For example, some transcription data sets collected with the Illumina sequencing pipeline we found were not proper in their quality to allow reliable clinical conclusions. Yeah? And we can advise the clinical partners to redo these measurements. Yeah? Even at the level of general clinical data, we are sometimes surprised how different data from the same patient recorded by different doctors can, how different such data can be. Yeah? So for example, something like height, you would not expect to change much for adult persons. Yet we found that there are sometimes deviations by up to 20 centimeters for the height of patients recorded by different patients, or sometimes even the gender is not a constant. Yeah, so again, this tells you that, let's say, in large cohorts, clinicians need support to keep their data clean, and we try to indicate them cases that need additional consideration. Yeah. There's a great problem how to make omics data useful for biomedical or industrial application. Yeah? This is only possible if the sequences are not just text, but we need some type of functional description associated with pieces of text. Yeah? And a functional description is not a one-liner, but a hierarchical concept in this situation. Yeah? That means that we need to have some idea about the location of genes, coding and non-coding, and the regions that regulate their transcriptional activity. In the cases of proteins, we need some idea about the molecular functions. These are the functional possibilities that are associated with the proteins themselves. We need to know about the cellular functions these proteins play in the larger context and how these cellular functions combined with some environmental influences create phenotypes. Yeah? If you go through the list of proteins or let's say genes today, then you will find that many of these functions many of these genomic regions lack any type of functional description. And let's say as a result of that, I would argue that for the general patient, genome sequencing is a useless exercise. Yeah, I omit this for the time being. Yeah. The hype in the media is mostly about the technological processes in sequencing, and to some extent about the advances in IT itself. Yeah, and when the let's say the genome was presented in 2001, it presented with such a pomp, even with some religious connotation that's somehow foreign for a scientist. Yeah, that. Let's say the normal, let's say the people outside science would have believed that the main problem is solved. Yeah, and most of the talk is about the decreasing cost in sequencing. But even this talk, I think, is very much exaggerated. If we are told that the sequencing cost is about $1,000 for a human genome or close to it, in fact, I think the real cost for some reasonable sequencing quality is at least 10 times this number now. And it will grow further with some level of genome-specific annotation. Yeah? And then there's a question whether it's really useful to sequence so many people now when the cost of storing the genome information on hard disks over the time period that's necessary to keep them until the moment when they can be analyzed compared with the cost for resequencing these genomes at a later time point when sequencing costs have gone down much further and the quality of sequencing is much enhanced compared with today. Yeah. So I think if there's no clear plan how to use the omics data now, it makes no sense to record it now, because there will be no need to analyze it later, because it can be cheaper and more accurately compiled at a later time point. Yeah. Yeah. The problem of missing functional annotation to genomic region, I think, is not sufficiently emphasized in the scientific literature and in the media. When at 10 years of the human genome presentation, I expected a similarly pompous celebration of the outcome, but nothing happened. And this guy, nobody can blame him to be very humble. Ask everybody to scale back expectations and not to expect quick returns or payoffs at this time point. Yeah, I do think that we know as much about biological mechanisms, especially in human, as never before in human history, but all our biomedical literature essentially maps to less than 1% of the human genome. Yeah, and this is the critical issue. If we take the last 10 years as a measure how fast this progress will evolve, yeah, then we come to certain shattering conclusions. In yeast, it is known that about 1,000 genes have no functional description, and the situation has not changed much during the last 10 years. The human genome, 1.5% of the genome is gene protein coding. That means that means about 20 to 25,000 genes, out of which 5,000 are functionally sufficiently characterized so that they can be used as entry for medical intervention. The remaining, let's say at least there's a group of 10,000 human genes which have essentially no functional description, especially at the molecular level. Yeah, and since most of the non-coding regions are transcribed into RNA that also has biological function, we can conclude for sure that far more than 50% of the human biology at the molecular level is still unknown today. Yeah? And most likely, many of these mechanisms play a key role in the development of disease. Yeah? And this is the main reason why development of cures, especially of new drugs for all kinds of diseases, fail at a high frequency. Yeah. So therefore, let's say if you see grants to review, you can take this as a criterion. If the proposed work has the potential to enhance our ability to attach functional annotation to genomes, especially to uncharacterized regions of those or to genes without function, then this is a potentially useful scientific work. Yeah. Yeah. Faster and cheaper sequencing will not lead to more biological understanding, but rather increase the heap of non-understood sequencing. Yeah, okay. Yeah. The last minutes of my talk, I want to provide you in brief with the history of gene function discovery we have made quite recently. Yeah, we have spent lots of work on the so-called GPI lipid anchor pathway for proteins. And this is a case where the gene or the protein sequence is known. The phenotypic function of these genes was also known, but it was not known what kind of molecular function is driving the phenotypic development. Yeah. The GPI lipid anchor biosynthesis pathway is a mechanism for the pre-synthesis of a very complex carbohydrate lipid structure, which is subsequently attached to proteins that are exported to the endoplasmic reticulum. It's an alternative way to anchor proteins to the outside of the plasma lemma compared with transmembrane regions. Yeah, the typical GPI lipid anchor protein has no transmembrane regions, but because of the anchor, it is lipid attached to the plasma lemma from the outside. Yeah? Before the pre-synthesized anchor can be attached, a C-terminal propeptide with a specific pattern is recognized by a so-called transamidase complex. At the new C-terminus, this pre-synthesized anchor is attached. It is known that the transamidase complex consists of 5 subunits. It was early understood one of the 5 subunits is a protease that cleaves the propeptide, and the function of the remaining 4 subunits remain clouded. Sequence analytic arguments in 2003 led us to the understanding that another subunit, called PICT, is a structural protein which has gating functions in front of the protease. So it's forming a tight complex with the protease and has a better propeller structure with the central channel, and the protein substrate travels through this channel to the catalytic site of the protease. And only substrate proteins with a specific pattern at the C-terminus can go through this channel. Yeah? So the function of the remaining 3 proteins remained unclear until 2014 when we started this work. Yeah? Okay, we try to crystallize some components with unknown function. And for example, 2 years ago, we celebrated the success of having crystals of PIGS, which the structure, the electron density map of which we could derive after great difficulties. We needed even to develop a new heavy atom deposition method to these crystals based on dysprosium atoms to achieve access to the phase in the electron density map calculation. But when we had a high resolution electron density map, we were unable to put the sequence of PIGS into this density map. And to our horror, we had crystallized another protein, in this case from the bacterium E. coli, which was used to express PIGS. And luckily, the structure of this protein was also not known. Yeah, just to give you an idea that even in the case of E. coli, there's lots of genes with unknown, non-understood functions and mechanisms. Yeah, so. But at the level of sequence analysis, we made some interesting discovery that a certain sequence in another subunit called GPAE1 has some distant similarity to bacterial proteases, to bacterial metalloproteases. That is the sequence of GPAE1 is drawn in this direction, and the region of similarity is this here. Yeah. So there's no doubt from this type of data that the structure of our target protein and the structure of these metalloproteases is identical. Yeah. So I still remember when my wife late in the evening, we already wanted to go to bed, said to me that she is horrified by a paradox, that there is a protease in a complex where she doesn't need a protease to be. Yeah, because there is already one, and for the one proteolytic reaction, it's known that this protease is doing this proteolytic reaction, the cleavage of the C-terminal propeptide. Why the hell do you need a second protease in the same complex? Yeah. So, and then we looked into the chemical structure, how the GPI lipid anchor is attached to the C-terminal residue of the substrate protein. And at this point, we paid attention to the fact that this lipid anchor is decorated with units of phosphoethanolamine. Yeah, I always asked myself already for many decades, since I was a student at medical school, why the hell the GPI lipid anchor needs phosphoethanolamine attached to the sugar moiety. Yeah? And in this situation, we understood that the phosphoethanolamine is necessary to make the carbohydrate lipid construct look like an N-terminus of a protein. Yeah? Actually, it's a peptide bond that links the complex structure with the C-terminus of the protein. Yeah? So, and this insight now makes great sense with the second protease in the complex, because the second protease doesn't work like a protease, but most likely it will be a peptide synthesis. Yeah? And sequence analytic studies have shown that the other two components cannot be proteases. So that in this situation, the theoretical argument is sufficient to conclude that GPA1 or GA1, as the name is in yeast, is the protein in the complex that leads to attachment of the anchor via a metallopeptide synthesis catalyzed bond. Yeah. So we know now a quite rich functional description for the subunit of the transaminidase complex. At the molecular level, we know that metallopeptide synthesis that catalyzes the emergence of a peptide bond between the complex carbohydrate lipid anchor and the C-terminally processed substrate protein. At the cellular level, from previous literature, is known that's localized at the internal surface of the endoplasmic reticulum as part of the transaminidase complex in the GPI lipid anchor biosynthesis pathway. And phenotypically, this complex is necessary to attach proteins to the outside of the plasma lemma if they don't have transmembrane regions. Yeah. Okay. I hope I have still some minutes for the final conclusion side. Yeah? Yeah? Okay. I think that despite tremendous societal needs, many areas in biomedicine and biotechnology will not develop because there is insufficient understanding of mechanisms that link genomic signatures as phenotypes. Yeah? We will have a dramatic improvement in application areas when these links are understood and these links are relevant for the application necessary. But it will take decades, if not longer, for applications that rely on mechanisms involving genes, the function of which is not discovered. Yeah. There will be a lot of technical developments that successfully use just the fact of comparing sequences without understanding the function. Yeah. But the most valuable applications are those who can mechanistically interfere into processes. Yeah. And since there is such a lag time, which might be longer than a generation or two, there's a great opportunity for lottery-type business and charlatans. Lottery-type business is when you don't even want to understand the mechanism and just try to find something that produces the desired effect. Yeah, but this is a very expensive betting. For example, a failed drug trial at stage three has accumulated costs in the range of hundreds of million dollars. Yeah, and not every pharma company can survive that frequently. And there's a lot of people who approach, let's say, the affluent part of society, promising them to derive lifestyle advice from their genomes. Yeah? In almost every country, there are some of these companies. I don't know how it's in Japan. Of course, you can sequence the genome of your client and do some analysis on it. You can also provide lifestyle advice, but how to link the two at current is scientifically very difficult, if not impossible. If impossible, yeah. So, and I think it would be great if we could tone down our promises to a realistic level to the political leadership that we are dealing with. And I think, let's say, this long-term professional argumentation, we can earn a reputation that, let's say, will provide us with funding, even if we don't promise fairy tales. Yeah. So thank you very much. And I hope you had some message to take home. Thank you.